Here we are again, Brother Peter. Tidbits from the Word. These two or three, four, this will be the fourth one this morning that I'm doing. This will be the last one today and that I'm doing. And I'm dedicating these to the Christian folks in Peru. My son's in Peru this week on a mission trip right by himself. Him and God. God and him. Which is the bigger, do you think? I'm sure God is. It's a humbling experience to leave your country, to leave your place of home, to leave your family home, to leave all that you know and are acquainted with, and go off and have your mind and your thought on others. That's what Nehemiah did. Nehemiah had totally had his thought on others, not on himself for a second. He did not think about himself at all during his period of time that he was besieged by many things from all points and all sides, and his total thought was, what would God have me do in this case? And it came to pass, it said, when I heard these words, that somebody had come and said, the walls were torn down and the city was besieged, in verse 4 of 1. I sat down and wept. When was the last time that you heard about somebody being in distress and you sat down and wept and you had a burden for them? A burden enough to get on your horse and ride, or a burden enough to get on your plane and fly, or a burden enough to do something about what you had the burden in your heart. Listen what he did. He sat down and wept and he mourned. There's a big difference between weeping and mourning. You can weep a little bit and not mourn. But he mourned. I say to my boys, many times I teach a Sunday school class with 13-year-old boys, and I say, hey, boys, when you lost your grandmama, you know that hole was in your heart? You know that feeling you had? Sometimes we have to have that feeling before somebody dies for them, to pray for them and to think about them and to do things. And sometimes we have to have that. And look what he said he did here. He fasted certain days and he prayed before the God of heaven. Now he set himself apart and he fasted and he prayed for the power of the God of heaven to be on him, and that his request, when it be made known to the king, that the king would deliver him what he asked. This is a peon guy, by the way, if you want to know the truth. Hey, this is a servant of the king, and he is going to ask what only perhaps a man in second command, well, I don't even think a second man in second command would ask what Nehemiah asked. Well, Nehemiah asked for a lot. He asked for the sun and the moon, and he got both. He said, I said, it beseeches thee, O God of heaven, the great and terrible God, and that keepeth the covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let thine ear be attentive. And we already covered this in our first excerpt today, but I just wanted to come back and show you in chapter 2, where he comes before the king now after he's done his praying and everything, and he starts asking the king. Now he steps up before the king. The first he did, he brought him a cup of wine. And his countenance was down. And the king said, tell me, you have never come before me before with your countenance down. What is the problem? And Nehemiah said, the king said, why is thy countenance down? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid. Hey, in that day you were not allowed to come before the king with your countenance down. Your problems were your problems, not the king's problems. You did not make your problems the king's problem. He didn't have any problems with you. What your problems were between you and God, and the king did not have anything to do with that. And now, and he said unto the king, let the king live forever. Now he swells the king up a little bit. Why should not my countenance be sad when the city, the place of my father's sepulchre, lieth waste, and the gates thereof, and are consumed with fire? Then the king said unto me, for what dost thou make request? So I prayed to the God of heaven. And I said unto the king, if it please thee, king, and of thy servant have found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me unto Judah, unto thy city of my father, sepulchre, that I may build it. And the king said unto me, listen to this now. Listen to this verse. This is astounding. This verse 6. And the queen also sitting by him, for how long shall thy journey be? And when wilt thou return? So it pleased the king to send me. It pleased the king to send him. Look at that. It pleased the king to send me. And I set him a time. How about that? It pleased the king. This is the king now that's over him. He's a king in a heathen land. We stole back in the book of Ezra. You go back to Ezra and you look where they besieged the city of Israel and they Jerusalem, and they burned it and tore it down and they did everything, and sent and this little boy became a captive, and he's been over there all this time. He said, moreover, I said unto the king, if it please thee, let letters be given unto me. Now he's adding things. First he's getting permission to go, and now he's saying, but look, I have nothing except God provided to for me through you, king. And more, and by the way, I believe with all my heart that Nehemiah was in the will of God from the day he was stolen to this day right here and to his end day. I believe he was a man that lived in the will of God in spite of the fact he was a servant over there in the place where he was, showing you you could be in the prison house today. I don't know how many people can get this in the prison house, but if you were and you got it, you could be in the prison house and still be a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Your circumstances does not have to negate whether you're happy or not. You can be in captive circumstances and be happy as can be, getting 3 meals a day, a roof over your head, and the ability to be able to preach for the Lord Jesus Christ, or be able to bring him to the forefront. Moreover, I said to the king, if it please the king, let letters be given unto me beyond the river, that they may convey me over till I come unto Judah. Now in that day, you could not cross borders, just walk across them, without written permission, or without letters, or without a passport, if you please, of some type. And a letter unto Asaph, the king of the king's forest. Now he's asking for something else. First he asked him for permission to go and a letter to get him across the river to get him there. Now he's asking of the keeper of the forest that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the palace, which obtain to the house and for the wall of the city and for the house that I shall enter into. And the king granted me according to the good hand of my God upon me. The king granted Nehemiah according to the good hand of God. Boy, this king is giving this lad everything that he needs, straight through, all of it. Hey, these guys in the forest were the only guys allowed to cut a tree down. Nobody else could cut a tree down. They couldn't go in the forest and cut a tree down. Search it out, look it out, figure it out, find out. Get in your Bible. By the way, there is no more interesting book in the world than the Bible, a holy Bible that God wrote and narrated from cover to cover, every bit of it printed by the Holy Spirit, put in here. By the way, Jesus said in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And that Word went away, and that Word came back. Now you and I have the living Word of God in our hand. If you please, we have Jesus in our hand, and this is his commandments. Then I came to the governors beyond the river and gave them the king's letters. And now the king had sent captains of the army and horsemen with me. Wow! Look at that. He has sent the horsemen and a great multitude of captains with him to protect him. And when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant and the Ammonite heard of it, it grieved them exceedingly that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. So I came to Jerusalem and was there 3 days. Now, a 3-day sabbatical, or a 3-day period. He had fasted and prayed some days, more than likely 3, and he came over there to Jerusalem. He's going to take another 3-day sabbatical, and he's not going to tell. Listen to what he says here. And I arose at night, and I sent a few men with me, neither told I any man what my God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem. Neither was there any beast with me, save the beast that I rode upon. Now he got on a jackass, or a mule, whichever you want to call it, and he went around the wall of Jerusalem. Did he make a full trip? I believe he made a full trip around the wall of Jerusalem, praying and seeking the face of God and saying, how are we going to do this, God? What would you have to be done here, Lord? And by the way, a great miracle is going to be performed in the amount of time it takes them to put this wall back up, even under duress. Even though they're under duress, and they're going to do it. Verse 13, I went out by night by the gate of the valley, even before the dragon wall, and the dung port, and viewed the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, and the gates thereof, which were consumed with fire. Then I went on to the gate of the fountain, and the king's pool, but there were the place for the beast that was under me to pass. There wasn't any place. The beast couldn't pass there. Then I went up to the night by the brook and viewed the wall and turned back and returned by the gate of the valley and returned. And the rulers knew not whether I went or what I did. Neither had I as yet told any of them. By the way, there were 12 gates. There are going to be 12 gates in the New Jerusalem. Those gates in the New Jerusalem will be open all the time. But these gates that are here are the same gates you and I have within our life. If we will look at our life, we have gates. We have the eye gate, the ear gate, the nose gate, the mouth gate, the foot gate, the hand gate, the finger gate, all kinds of gates we have that we can open and use for the Lord. And here, he started with a valley gate where the valley came up and people came through the valley, came up and came in the valley gate and the fountain gate, the gate where the water flowed freely, and the sheep gate, the gate where the sheep were brought in and out and brought to the water. And the fish gate, the gate where the food came in and out. And the old gate, the gate that was on the original wall of the city of David when it was built. And then the dung gate, and that's the place where they took all of the waste that was waste from the city out into that valley there and burned it. Day and night that fire burned and burned it. And the water gate. Where the water was, and the horse gate, where the horses came and went, and the east gate. Now the east gate was shut up eventually, and is shut today until the Lord comes back. And then the gate of Michlad, and the gate of Ephraim, and the prison gate. Now all of these gates represent, if we will study out everything about these gates, they all represent, just like us, you and I. What goes in this gate right here? You see this water? This is the water gate where I take the water in to function. So this building of God, of Jesus Christ. I am the building of Jesus Christ now. He can function through me and in me as he will, I allow him. Now, we see that Jesus is going to give me everything he gave Nehemiah. He gave Nehemiah everything he needed to function. And he's going to give you and I everything we need to function in our life if we're going to function the way he would have us to do. And the rulers knew not where I went. Then said I unto them, ye see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come, and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach. This is what the preacher said a little while ago to me, and I caught it. He said, it's not right that the people of God be under such reproach that we are paying money that could go to the church, to the doctor. We are paying the doctors left and right and left, for things that should be healed, for things that should God could take care of. I have a real purpose in my life to be sure, and witness directly, face to face, eyeball to eyeball, to my doctor, and give him a track every time I go in there. Sir, if you died right now, would you go to heaven? And I have a foreign doctor, a doctor who does not believe, as far as I know, the way we believe. He has never given me an inkling that he or said anything left or right, but he has put the track in his pocket and left. And I give the nurses, the one that draws the blood, the one that does everything, the one that collects the bills, all of the ladies up at the front. Hey, all of them know when I come in as a preacher. I come in as a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm not going to keep my mouth shut. I'm going to witness. I'm going to pass tracts out in the waiting room. I'm going to talk about the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is going to lead the way and meet the need for the day. All right, let's get on. All right, now we find out that he's there. And he's going to go, and he's going to appoint priests, and he's going to appoint things, and he's going to do the things of God. And I wanted to get to a point. The descendants of the tribe, he was from Judah, and there was a brother he had, we believe, in here, and they were... from the descendants of the Levites and the singers and the priests and those people that he was going to set up to be the finished work of the city, to take care of it after it was done, to set it back up, set the house of God back up, that all people would worship again. He built all the gates. It talks about the gates he built here and on through to chapter 4. And the building of all of the gates that he built, and he overcame, had to have a sword in one hand and a trowel in the other. And there was an opposition that was against him as he built. There was an opposition of anger by people who were godless people. They were angry. They were radical against him. They had conspiracies against him and brought a type of war against him in chapter 7 and verse 8. They continually threatening him. Listen, you don't have to pay attention to verbal threats from people. You don't have to pay attention. A man can threaten you all the way to the grave and never act upon that threat. So don't let a shadow deter you. A shadow of a knife never killed anybody. The shadow of a gun never killed anybody. The shadow of something never hurt anybody. And there is no shadow or turning in the way of the Lord, by the way. And so he had a continual threatening. There was a craftiness that was against him, continually underlying craftiness and above board. And there were accusations about him. There was treachery brought to him. He paid attention to none of it. He went on his way and did what he was supposed to do. And his last prayer, he made five requests. Hear, O God, in verse 4, my prayer. Turn the reproach upon their own head. Give them for a prey in the land of captivity. Cover not their iniquity. Let not their sin be blotted out from before you. He's talking about those that came directly against the God of heaven. He's saying, God, you take care of them. I'm not going to worry about it. You take care of them. And that's what we need to do. You know that's a tough thing to do. It's a tough thing to do for us today, to give it over to God and to let God take care of it. And there's one more thing I wanted to do before I closed. I wanted to bring up that I'm believing, and I haven't gone back and researched it recently, that it was like 58 days they built back a wall that took years and years and years to build. And the Bible said that every man had a mind to work. Every man had a mind to work. That's working together. Every man had a mind to work. There is not a church anywhere that will prosper if the people in it don't have a mind to work. The people have got to have a mind to work. It takes work to get things done. You have to leave the house to get things done outside of the house. You have to go out the door to get things done outside. When you are walking out of the church building, there needs to be a sign over the door that says, you are now entering the mission field. You are now entering the mission field. And the mission field is where you go. That's going. First at home, then Jerusalem and Judea and the uttermost part of the world. My time has come and gone. I can't seem to get enough time to get these down today. But we'll see you next time. Bye-bye, wherever you are in the world. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.